Look, it's all education.
Yeah.
It's all higher education. And the willingness of the governments and the politicians to put the money in there.
Right.
AI and biology are merging, and that will become very important in the future. It's already becoming important.
Hi, friends and fellows. Welcome to this special series of conversations involving personalities coming from a number of campuses, including Stanford University. The purpose of the series is really to unleash thought-provoking ideas that I think would be of tremendous value to you. I want to thank you for your support so far, and welcome to this special series.
It's such an honor to have Professor Harvey Lodish, who's a founding member of the Whitehead Institute and also professor of biology and biomedical engineering at MIT. Harvey, thank you so much for the time.
Well, it's a pleasure to be on your show and look forward to talking with you.
Thank you. Thank you. I want to explore a little bit about where and how you grew up. You came from Ohio, and of all the great universities that you could have gone, but you chose to go to a small college. Tell us.
Right. I was a very good student in high school, and everyone assumed I would go to Harvard. I applied to Harvard. It was the only school I applied to. I got in. I got a nice scholarship, but I had visited Harvard, and I realized it was simply too big, too impersonal. I suppose at the time I was pretty insecure, and I went to my high school guidance counselor and said, where should I go to study chemistry and mathematics? And she suggested Kenyon College. At the time, it was an all-men's school.
Right.
About 400 students.
But it hasn't grown that much.
It's now 1,600, and it's co-ed. But I went there, spent a lot of time with a couple of the professors, and realized that I could get exactly the education I wanted. I could organize my own class schedule and take the courses that I wanted. I double majored in chemistry and mathematics and graduated in 3 years. Two of the courses, there were only two students. And one of the courses I put together, I had to do 3 semesters of physical chemistry in one. And the physical chemistry professor was on sabbatical. But they had a visitor who had just done a PhD in biophysical chemistry. And I talked with him, and we agreed to have a course. There was a book that had just been published called Biophysical Chemistry that neither he, of course, nor I had read. And we agreed that for the course, we would read the book together. He would give me lots of problems to solve. And in parallel, I would read the standard textbook on physical chemistry, which I found slightly boring. Anyway, I learned biophysical chemistry and physical chemistry and did it very efficiently on a one-on-one course with a professor. And that's the kind of thing you get in a small liberal arts college. You simply can't get it in a large university. So I'm forever grateful to Kenyon that it was really a privilege to be there and have that kind of education.
I can relate to this a lot because I'm sort of a product of a liberal arts education earlier.
And what the world doesn't know is that liberal arts colleges, certainly in the, well, they're almost unique to the United States. That's the first point. Most of them started as church-related institutions to train ministers in the new wilderness that America was expanding into. And yet, they produce a large fraction of our leading scientists for exactly the sorts of classes that I just talked about.
Yeah, we'll get to that in a bit, but let's, you know, there's been some great personalities coming out of Kenyon College, including yourself, of course. A great actor, a former president.
Paul Newman.
Yeah.
But
you acted with him.
I was in a Kenyan development movie where we were together. Although I've never met him, but my daughter Heidi went there. She met her husband there.
Right.
Their daughter Emma just graduated from Kenyan, and I've taught there. I've taught a seminar class a number of years ago on stem cells, and I hope to go back to Kenyan and teach a short course on biotechnology this coming fall. So it's always been a big part of my life. I also served on the board of trustees at Kenyon for almost 20 years.
You went on to Rockefeller University.
I did.
Which is a great university that, unfortunately, not a lot of people in Asia are aware of.
Well, they should be, because a lot of the students at Rockefeller are foreign.
Okay.
And again, I picked Rockefeller over, well, let me go back. Right. I went to graduate school. I started graduate school in 1962.
Okay.
And molecular biology was an emerging field. It was not even an established part of biology. There were only three or four universities in the United States that had substantial research in molecular biology, Rockefeller being one, Berkeley and Stanford being the others.
Right.
In a sense, I was taking a risk by going into a brand new field, but there was something about understanding biology at a molecular level that appealed to me. And Rockefeller was, again, a perfect place for me. The whole graduate class that I entered with was about 20 students. And even to this day, several of them are my best friends.
Yeah. Many of them are Nobel laureates, too.
I have friends there.
I remember how the story of your encountering
David. I'll tell you, it was my first, my parents were very, very conservative and were quite upset that I wasn't in medical school, which is where they thought I should be. And it got worse during my first day at Rockefeller, because I was shown into my single room, but I was sharing a bathroom with the next room, and the person in the next room was a hippie. I mean, he seemed nice enough, but my mother's parting words were, you know, Harvey, he's not our kind. You shouldn't have anything to do with him. Now, 13 years later, when that hippie, David Baltimore, won the Nobel Prize in Medicine, then it was completely different.
The message
all over Cleveland, exactly. You know, my son's best friend just won a Nobel Prize. Okay? And David, to this day, is still one of my best friends.
Right.
And this is 60 years ago, almost. But that's the atmosphere then. I mean, these were a lot of very bright, very creative, very interesting people who were going into molecular biology. And I was privileged to know and work with many of them.
Right.
So on my thesis committee were two Nobel laureates, Ed Tatum and Fritz Lippmann. And then later, I was privileged to be a postdoc at the molecular biology laboratory in Cambridge, England, probably the world's leading center for molecular biology, where I was able to work with Francis Crick, who had just won the Nobel Prize for DNA structure, and also with Sidney Brenner, who was going to win a Nobel Prize. And one or two of my classmates did win one of Nobel Prizes from there.
And you got an offer to teach at Berkeley. And you somehow...
Well, no. Okay. I was in my last year at... Well, I'll tell you. I was in... No, it's because of Ronald Reagan that I'm at MIT. Okay. So my last year at Rockefeller in 1966, I was invited to give a series of lectures at Berkeley, which turned out to be a job interview. And they offered me a faculty position that I would take up in 1968 after my postdoc. And I actually accepted the job that summer.
Right.
I had to sign a loyalty oath, and explaining to a British barrister what an American loyalty oath is something else. But I was actually listed on the faculty of the University of California, Berkeley. But that was 1967. This was the peak of the Vietnam War, the peak of the anti-war movement, the peak of Students for Democratic Society, SDS, and so forth. And that fall, Ronald Reagan got elected governor of California and started putting the screws on Berkeley, particularly, that the faculty should spend more time with students and not politicking and so forth. And I was very concerned. I was in England, and I resigned. And then, God bless him, Salvador Luria, who was on the faculty at MIT then, again, a future Nobel laureate, recruited me to MIT.
Wow.
And I've been here my whole professional career. It's been the most fabulous place in the world to be able to do research. And in particular, I get to work with some of the literally brightest students in the world.
Tell us about what you've been doing all this time, you know, the field that you've been working on.
Yeah, it's called molecular biology. When I was trained as a graduate student and postdoc, the research was almost entirely on bacterial cells and viruses that infect bacterial cells, because experimentally, that's what we knew how to handle. There was very little, if any, work on what we call eukaryotic cells, cells with the true nucleus that would include yeast, but more importantly, include, you know, humans and fruit flies and worms and things of that sort, experimental. And we were just beginning to work on these higher cells. So soon after I arrived at MIT, my laboratory started working on the formation of red cells, and particularly on the protein hemoglobin, which is the major protein in red blood cells. I mean, to give you an idea, we didn't know how proteins initiated in higher cells. We knew that a methionyl tRNA was the initiator in bacterial cells, but we really had no idea what amino acid, if any, was the specific initiator in higher cells. And I had a brilliant graduate student, David Hausman, who figured out how to solve the problem. And I think it was 3 years after I joined the MIT faculty, we published a paper showing that it was methionine. And that really was the last letter of the genetic code. And then at that time, I had my first sabbatical visitor, who was then a young MD from Children's Hospital named David Nathan. So he was a hematologist who, I guess, had heard that molecular biology was going to be the future of academic medicine, and came to my lab. And together we studied a disease of hemoglobin synthesis, which you may know is quite common now in Southeast Asia, beta thalassemia, where one of the two globin chains is not made in the right amount. And we figured out, this is 1970, so we're talking over 50 years ago. We designed an experiment to show that it was an insufficient amount of the messenger RNA that made the beta globin. Now, we of course had no cloning or anything like that, but we could establish that the message just wasn't there. The small amount of message that was there functioned normally, but it didn't make a sufficient amount of the beta globin, so you had the disease. So it was the beginning of using molecular biology to understand medicine. And that started, for me, a 50-year involvement with Children's Hospital.
You set pretty much the foundation for molecular biology. Talk a little bit about how the process of writing that molecular cellular biology book.
Oh, the textbook.
Yeah, which is a precondition for anybody that wants to be in this field. All over the world.
Well, it's a graduate level textbook.
Yeah.
We use it in undergraduate courses at MIT. That came later. In the 70s, I taught molecular biology, but it was mostly molecular biology of bacterial cells, because again, that is what we knew. And then 77, 78, I was in sabbatical in London. And then when I came back, I started teaching with Mary Lou Pardue, a faculty colleague, the first cell biology course at MIT. There had never been a course in cell biology until 1978. And we taught the first one, which was sort of a combined graduate-undergraduate class. And I accumulated enough notes that I thought it would be useful to have a textbook.
You thought it would be easy, too, to write it.
Well, it was a long story. I'll try to shorten it. But basically, I wrote the first two editions with David Baltimore.
Right.
And Jim Donnell, who is a distinguished professor at Rockefeller. And Jim and David handled the nuclear part, that is, the structure of DNA and how DNA is copied into RNA and all of the sort of molecular aspects. And my part covered the rest of the cell, the cytoplasm, protein synthesis, protein secretion, what we knew back then about how cells move, how they muscle cells contract, how they interact with other cells, that sort of thing. And yes, I said, you know, I can write, I forget, 10 chapters in 6 months, which indeed I did. The problem, and I was a good writer. I mean, I went to Kenya and I really knew how to write and I wrote well, but as a textbook, it was a disaster. And they finally, the publishers, Scientific American Press then, got me a scientific editor who worked with me chapter by chapter and pointed out, you know, Harvey, you know, in this heading, you said that in this section, I'm going to cover A, B, and C. And there were 5 pages on A and a page on B, and you never quite got to C, you see. And, you know, I just wasn't conscious of how to put together a textbook.
Right.
But I learned quickly.
Right.
And the first two editions, as I said, I did with Jim and David. And then they decided to step back, and we started recruiting a number of other authors. And I have to say, writing this book, particularly with my co-authors, has been a very enriching experience. Before we were, there are 9 editions, and before each edition, we would meet for a couple of days and just talk. You know, what's new in science? What should we include? What are the hot new things that are solid enough that they belong in a textbook?
Right.
You see. And what could we exclude? What's old? Are there techniques that we're covering that people aren't using now? And that sort of thing. So those discussions were very, very informative and figured out who was going to write what chapter. Each chapter has a major author, but each chapter is read by 1 or 2 other authors. So it's really a community effect.
It's been translated into,
Well, it's been translated into
a number of languages.
It's in 14 languages.
My gosh. When is the Indonesian version going to come out?
We'll have to ask Nova. I would love it. The Vietnamese edition came out.
Oh, my gosh.
The last
they got one. Ahead of us.
Well, no, do you know there was a Vietnamese edition?
I heard about it.
Yeah, no, again, it was a student of mine, Minh Le, who is now a professor at National University in Singapore, but she grew up in Hanoi. And she organized the Vietnamese translation of the book and really found about a dozen Vietnamese who were fluent enough in English and knowledgeable enough about the science to translate it. So it came out. Do I see any of them here? I had a couple on my on the desk.
This is the English version.
That's the English
the
version.
The fourth edition.
There's one.
This one. Oh, no.
No, that's Japanese. Anyway, now.
We got to work on translating into Bahasa or Indonesian.
Well, and my understanding, correct me if I'm wrong, is that that would work also in Malaysia?
Yeah.
You see?
In some parts of Thailand, too.
Okay, well, you know, what we worked out for the Vietnamese edition, it was published in 5 small paperback books.
Okay.
Each one costing about $4 or $5.
Yep.
So the idea was to make it very inexpensive and make it accessible to everybody.
Right.
And nobody made money on it. So I arranged that there were no royalties to the authors, either the authors of the American edition or of the Vietnamese edition. The publishers in New York got no revenue from it.
Right.
There was an excellent publisher, Trey, in Ho Chi Minh City that, of course, did earn money on it. It was when, back in 2019, I was there for celebrating the publication of the last two volumes. And I was a bit of a celebrity. They had a,
you still are.
Well, no, I mean, this was...
I can't believe I'm in the
room
with
you. My picture was on a huge bulletin board on a major street in Ho Chi Minh City. And the street was filled with about 500 students, and there was a band. And,
oh, man, we got to get a billboard
really,
with your face on it.
It was really quite rewarding, and I sat there for about 2 hours autographing copies of the book. And...
Amazing.
I mean, it sounds hokey, but, you know, these were students who were standing in line to get a copy of the book so that they could read it. And this is a science book. This is not a comic
book. Your
book
is the holy book for anybody that wants
to read it. Well, it's not holy. It's not religious.
It's the metaphor of a Bible.
It is one of the most used books in graduate courses in this.
Yeah.
And it covers a lot of areas from... transcription and DNA replication and everything to do with gene expression and
Correct.
Its regulation to stem cells to how the nervous system functions, how the immune
Right.
system functions. So it's used very broadly. And at a personal level, our daughter used the fourth edition when she was in medical school. And one of my grandsons just graduated from the University of Virginia and used Grandpa's textbook in his cell biology course. But he has a different last name than me.
Okay.
So...
Did you offer any tutorial?
Well, no. Isaac was very talented, put it that way. His name is in the book in the acknowledgement section, but nobody reads it. So his professor had no idea that his grandpa wrote the book. But that's okay.
I want to push on this. I think it's important for people to understand a little bit better about the process of education. Right? You've grown up. You've been working with so many Nobel laureates, even to the point where you've actually mentored a couple of Nobel laureates.
Two of my postdoctoral fellows, Aaron Chicanover and James Rothman, went on to win the Nobel Prizes.
Right.
Yes. And eight of my students are in the U.S. National Academy of Sciences. I don't know that it's a record, but
I think it is.
I'm very proud of their accomplishment.
Okay, as a Southeast Asian, I'm sort of vested in what it would take for Southeast Asia to be up there, you know, in terms of being recognized at that kind of level.
You need to build top-level universities and put in the money to generate the facilities that will attract and retain world-class people.
From anywhere around the world?
From anywhere around the world, but particularly from Indonesia.
Yeah.
You know, I'm staring at one of them right now. You know, one of the most talented undergraduates from Indonesia,
right.
Valentino,
right.
You know, came to MIT. He's now in graduate school at Stanford. He's getting a fabulous education. Now, whether he will go home to Indonesia is an interesting question. And if he does, are there facilities, universities, laboratories where he could do his research and train Indonesians students at this sort of high international level? And it's much deeper than just saying we need a great university. I mean, countries like, well, every country, they have diseases that are common, particularly genetic diseases,
right.
that are common or abundant in a particular area, perhaps an island. There are agricultural issues that
right.
need modern technologies, improving yields of crops, that kind of thing.
Right.
biological technologies as part of climate remediation, where you really want your own talented students to stay there and do research that will benefit the country specifically.
Right.
You know, Indonesia should be able to make many of its own pharmaceuticals,
yeah.
you see, and innovate some new ones that, right. I mean, for instance, a disease like beta thalassemia is endemic in many parts of Indonesia, as it is throughout Southeast Asia. And we have gene therapies for it that work in the United States, but these are very expensive, very complicated technologies.
Yeah.
And can one develop gene therapies that could be used on a mass level to eliminate the suffering of beta thalassemia?
Right.
You see, it's just as an example of the kind of thing that could be done
yeah.
that requires highly trained people with a lot of facilities. So when I'm asked this question, I always look at the universities
Correct.
To start with.
Right.
And, you know, in parallel to develop the secondary schools that will train the people at a high enough level so that they can do this work at a high level in the universities.
Well, you know, what Valentino is doing, what Nova is doing, they're an extension of what you've been doing, right?
Oh, yeah.
And I think the application of what they're doing will be so tremendous for not just Indonesians, but many people around the world.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, they're both working at, you know, the highest level and the top
Correct.
Institutions. I mean, Nova is now the CEO of a company that is developing novel treatments for certain autoimmune diseases.
Right, right.
And these
autoimmune... Which is relevant to a lot of situations in Indonesia.
Well, it's relevant. Autoimmune diseases are common throughout
yeah.
the world. No ethnic group is spared.
Correct.
And yet the work right now has to be done in the United States because
yeah.
there aren't facilities. On the other hand, we're talking about establishing a manufacturing facility for
yeah.
some of these recombinant proteins in Indonesia. Now
right.
that would be new there, but
oh.
again, it would be an example of what could be done. But we'd have to train the people inside in
right.
the country to run these machines.
Yeah. Do you see biotechnology more as a remedial technology as
well,
opposed to something that could be augmenting upon a pre-existing condition?
Well, right now we see it as long-term therapies. Particularly therapies for diseases that are lethal or very, very debilitating.
Yeah.
I mean, the two that my lab is focused on and several of my companies focus on are sickle cell disease, which is endemic in equatorial Africa.
Right.
And then beta thalassemia, which is, you know, endemic in Southeast Asia. I mean, these are huge public health problems.
Right.
And much of courses that I teach in biotech focus on these. And the gene therapies are spectacular and they do work, but they're very expensive and they involve long-term hospitalizations and they will cost in the millions of dollars, which may be tenable in the United States. We're not sure.
Not so in other countries.
But it's certainly not tenable in any lower middle income country.
Right. I want to talk to you about CRISPR. What's your take on CRISPR? I mean, that's been proven to be good for sickle cell disease. And
yeah, CRISPR is a kind of, it's actually not one technique, it's several techniques. It's basically a way of bringing a protein to a specific piece of the DNA of the genome. And in the original iteration, when it goes to that site in the genome, it cuts the DNA. But modifications of it means it can change one base, it can induce expression of that region of the gene. There are a lot of clever things that CRISPR can do that aren't in the public press. And a lot of groups are trying to develop this into real therapies. The difficulty is getting the CRISPR itself into the right cells.
Mm.
Once it gets there, it can do great things, but
right.
getting it into the cells. Cells normally don't like to take up foreign proteins, you say. So you have to use tricks, or they don't like to take up foreign DNA, which could instruct the cell to make the protein. So it's complicated, right. And yet it is working in several companies, and it will be very useful. But how we're going to pay for it is another issue.
You see this as being transformative in the near foreseeable future?
Yes, if a lot of these technical problems can get solved. It will be used in how many diseases for what purpose remains to be seen.
Pediatric blindness is another, right?
Yeah. I think diseases right now, everyone's talking about either lethal or very debilitating diseases. Right. I mean, sickle cell is not generally lethal, but it can be debilitating.
Right.
And it certainly shortens the half-life, the lifetime of the person.
Right.
But, you know, we talked earlier, I have a grandson with Gaucher disease, and he's being treated quite successfully with enzyme replacement therapy. Yep. And we don't know the long-term risks of gene therapy. I mean, I could make a gene therapy for him in my laboratory. Technically, that's not all that complicated.
Right.
But would I subject him to this right now? The answer is no, because we don't know the long-term effects.
Right.
Perhaps in 10 years, when there's more safety profiles and things like that. These are brand new technologies, you say.
Yeah. Well, you know, you hear stories about genetic editing. Right.
Yeah. Well, this is part of the CRISPR.
Sounds a little bit scary because people tend to interpret it as something that could actually augment humanity, increasing the IQ of a person.
Well, okay. You have to be careful with what you mean. We are not gene editing the germ cells. In other words, the only cells that we have that pass on genetic information to our offspring are the sperm and the eggs. And right now, these are not being edited, and there are prohibitions everywhere so that you don't do that. It can be done technically. That's not the issue.
Right.
So it's done on what we call the somatic cells, the cells that form our tissues and organs, but are not passed on to our offspring.
Mm.
And my instincts are that rule's going to stay for quite a long time.
In most countries.
Hopefully in all countries. Hopefully in all countries.
You don't see the geopolitics of things reshaping?
There's no rational...
Where the line gets drawn?
There's no reason you would want to change the DNA of your offspring. There are other ways of preventing passing on bad genes to your offspring. And for the record, there's no easy way of doing gene therapy on sperm or egg cells anyway.
Okay. But what about conversations that talk about potentially increasing somebody's IQ?
That is far in the future, if it will ever happen. There is no single gene that controls IQ. There are certainly mutations that cause intellectual disability. And one might want to treat those in a young child. I mean, in fact, for instance, one of my companies is focusing on gene therapy for Dravet, which is a pediatric epilepsy.
Right.
But also, the children have enormous developmental defects. Now, it may be that our gene therapy would correct the developmental defects and the children would be able to speak, which they currently cannot do, or do so poorly. On the other hand, that trait would not be passed on to the offspring. You see, it would be, again, somatic gene therapy, in this case, to the brain.
Right.
And there one would argue, sure, if you can take a nonverbal child and get her to talk, that would be huge, you see. Again, we're talking about correcting genetic defects and not trying to improve
something. More therapeutic.
Yeah, exactly. And you know, the studies of intelligence have clearly said that there's no easy way of putting a gene in and increasing your intelligence. And for that matter, even measuring intelligence is complicated, and there's a lot of discussion about what that means. So
right.
It's not something I can see happening in the near future, no.
I want to get to the business side of things, right? You've been exposed to, you know, combining science and business since the 60s and 70s. And you've been a big part of making Boston or Cambridge the way it has turned out in
well,
the last
yes.
few decades. Right?
I mean, in 1961,
right.
I was working in an organic chemistry laboratory at Stanford. I was a Kenyan right. undergraduate, and the head of the lab, Kyle Gerasi, was a Kenyan graduate, one of the world's great organic chemists.
Right.
But he had also realized that starting from a particular chemical in a Mexican tree, he could synthesize the molecules that became the basis of the oral contraceptive, the birth control pill.
Yeah.
And when I was at Stanford in 61, I would visit Syntex SA, his company, because
right.
his graduate students would work part-time there and part-time in the Stanford lab. And I could see what was going on. It never occurred to me that I would be part of this sort of thing. But 20 years later, when cloning was coming along, and there was for the first time the ability to isolate the gene for any protein and manufacture the protein, that the first generation of biotech was born, which were all recombinant proteins or monoclonal antibodies. So that's when I got involved together with seven colleagues from MIT in founding Genzyme, which made the first enzyme replacement.
Oh my gosh, it turned out okay. It became so big.
Yeah, well,
this was- You got acquired by Sanofi, right?
Well, we did, but this was the vision, not of the eight scientists particularly, but of Henry Termeer, who was the businessman,
yeah.
who was the president.
Right.
Who realized that one could build a company on recombinant enzyme replacements for rare genetic diseases. As I may have mentioned, my grandson has Gaucher, who's been on the Genzyme drug for, 9 or 10 years now. Now, it's covered by insurance, but his insurance pays about $200,000 a year for the product. Mm. So it's not inexpensive. On the other hand, it's allowed him to lead a perfectly normal life.
Right. Tell us a story about how you first discovered money, right?
How I discovered
money. Your scientific pursuit was actually worth a lot more than you thought when you met up with an investment banker.
Well, this was at the very beginning when I was talking, this is well before Genzyme, when
you met a lady.
She was our next door neighbor, Linda.
Right.
And we were just talking about the possibilities of biotechnology. And she worked for a small investment bank in downtown Boston and brought me there one day for lunch. I'd never been in, you know, this kind of environment, but I was sitting at a lunch table with a group of bankers and just talking in general about the research in my laboratory, making recombinant proteins and so forth. And at one point, the head of the bank turned to me and said, you know, Harvey, we like you and we like your research and we'd like you to start a company and we'll give you $5 million. Now, that was a lot of money and certainly more than I had ever heard of in my life. So I was kind of stunned by it and didn't know what to say. So I said nothing. And the gentleman, seeing my unease, turned to me and said, well, you know, if money's a problem, I'm sure we can get you $10 million. And this is not a joke. I realized what I was worth. The laboratory that I had built and the research that we were doing had measurable value in the commercial world. And I never followed up on that, but it was that conversation that led me to talk to a lot of my faculty colleagues at MIT. Many of them were given similar offers, and eight of us formed, this is pre-Genzyme, we formed a professional consulting group called BIA, Bioinformatics Associates, where we did a lot of consulting throughout the world on biotechnology. We actually positioned ourselves as strategic management consultants to advise multinational corporations on the impact of biotech on their core business. And that taught us a lot. I mean, there were five of us spent a whole wonderful week in Paris with a food conglomerate. But I'm not joking. I mean, they took us to the Stella Artois brewery.
It's just amazing.
And asked, you know, what impact will biotech have on the brewery, on the beer industry? Because there were notions that you could use the yeast to make recombinant human proteins, which made no sense. Anyway, the simple answer is it has no effect, and they're willing to pay handsomely for it. But this was the group that wound up putting Genzyme together.
Wow.
So, you know, it was a very interactive group. No, we were all from different fields. I was a cell biologist, there were organic chemists, there were biophysical chemists, food process engineers, bioreactor designers, and so forth. And we really worked together as a group to put together Genzyme and then to serve as a scientific advisory board.
What did you learn in terms of having the ability to combine science and entrepreneurship? And I want to take this a little bit further. The biotech industry has just blossomed, right?
Right, and what you said is key. That is what I've learned and what I try telling governments throughout the world. The key is actually faculty entrepreneurs.
Yeah.
You know, the faculty members in whose lab certain discoveries were made that they realized could be converted into a therapeutic or a diagnostic, who then work with the business folk to set up and run a company. And, you know, as you may know, I've started probably a dozen companies. But when I say start, I will serve on the scientific advisory board. I'm not allowed to actually run the company.
Right.
And I'd be incompetent to run a company. That's not my skill. My skill is evaluating science and figuring out how to make things work better and so forth.
Yeah.
The business end, I leave to the business people.
How easy is it to replicate faculty entrepreneurship? Because
we teach it all the time. I mean, I learned
here, but you know, I'm sure there are so many countries out there that want to replicate what Cambridge has
done.
No.
When I joined the Children's Hospital Board of Trustees, I worked with their technology licensing office, and they set up really mini courses for faculty. You know, most faculty have no idea what a patent is. We can start there. You see, what exactly is in a patent? What protection does a patent give you? Does a patent allow you to sell your product? No. It prevents other people from following your invention. Well, that's very different, you see. So, you know, a 1 or 2 hour course on what is a patent becomes very important. What is venture capital? How do you fund a company? You see, that's something that is mysterious to
faculty
outside of a few, even in the United States,
right.
You see. So that's what I try to do when I go to countries like, I mean, where have I been recently? Japan, Singapore, France.
China. India.
Well, I was in India, but as a tourist. Although I have been there on that when I was in Calcutta.
Right.
I've been all over. I've been to Chile and I've been to other countries.
We got to talk about your visit to Indonesia. You were there quite recently.
I've been a couple times to Indonesia.
I know.
As a tourist.
What was your take on a country? Which parts of Indonesia did you visit, and what turned you off or what turned you on?
Well, I mean my wife and I.
Well, you and the family.
Yeah, and we like going off the beaten track. So one of our first visits, we went to Borobudur because it's, you know, touted as the largest Buddhist monument in the world. In fact, much of the base is Hindu.
Right.
But And I'm proud of the fact when I saw the complex, the monument, I recognized what it actually was. But anyway,
but Buddhism was first in Indonesia before Hinduism came over.
No, the foundation is Hindu.
Oh yeah, I mean the foundation. If we were to go back hundreds. That would have been in India.
Yeah. But the base of the statue, the base of Borobudur, the whole.
You're right.
Bas-reliefs on the ground
floor. There's Hindu influence.
It is not Hindu influence. It is Hindu.
Okay, fair enough.
It is Hindu, and then the second layer is Buddhist. Anyway, I like this kind of stuff.
Yeah.
And that trip was Borobudur, and then we went to Toraja.
Hang on, you went to Prambanan also.
Prambanan, yeah.
Yeah.
I like
which would have been Hindu.
Prambanan was Hindu. Yeah. Well, there were three temples.
Correct.
And then we went to Toraja, and it was just fascinating.
You survived a 7-hour car ride, or you stopped over somewhere?
We drove from Makassar to Pene, stayed the night, and then drove up to Toraja.
Okay.
You know, if you want to visit interesting places, it takes time to get there. But then more recently, my wife and I went back with three of our young grandchildren. Well, I
there
guess it's
Flores that. And
yeah,
Bali.
And we spent quite a bit of time in Bali, where I officiated at the wedding of Nova, one of my students, on the beach in Denpasar. But then the whole wedding party got on two boats. We flew to Flores Island and got on two boats and visited the Komodo Island and Komodo dragons. And it was fabulous. So, you know, as a tourist, it's a fabulous place to be. And, you know, the people are very hospitable.
Yeah.
We had just every place we went, it was just very, very pleasant and interesting. You know, I remember particularly in Toraja, we went for long walks into the villages and so forth. And we would just meet people, and they were just the most open, you know, wonderful, hospitable people. I mention that because it is a Muslim country. And
oh, but it's diverse.
It's very, you know, several of our friends were concerned that we were going to a Muslim country. I'm telling you, this
they
is
were the, watching the wrong channel.
They were watching the wrong channels in the United States. And I kept saying, no, this is not what Islam is. And Indonesia was entirely safe.
But that's a general observation about Indonesia. Here's the fourth most populous country in the world, the third largest democracy in the world.
Yeah.
But nobody talks about it enough.
Well, right? This is why I was privileged to spend time there.
Yeah.
And to see it and to meet, you know, some of the people, of course.
Yeah.
And I've had many Indonesian students here.
Well, I mean, there should be more, if not a lot more. I mean, the representation of Indonesia through the Valentinos of the world, the Novas of the world, could be more compared to some other countries of scale.
No, I agree with you.
Yeah.
Many countries send more of their top young people abroad.
Right.
And that certainly would help. But again, I argue that you really want to build the universities in the country.
I agree.
That, you know, many countries I've visited in Asia and, for that matter, in South America, the elite all send their children abroad.
Share your thoughts or observations about the Indian universities and the Chinese universities.
Yeah, well, again, I've been to probably a dozen in each country. India, I was very saddened when I visited. Universities. The ones I visited really were 20, 30, 40 years out of date, just in terms of the facilities. The government just doesn't spend enough money there. And what I learned is, at least a few years ago when I checked it, it was something like 0.7% of the GDP in the country was spent on research,
right,
which is far lower than the G20. And then, on the other hand, I've been to China probably a dozen times in the last 10 years. And when I first visited China in 1995, the universities and the research institutes were really struggling from the aftermath of the Cultural Revolution. Right. And what I learned is there were only about 10 million university students in the entire country. China, albeit not a democracy, has built dozens, if not more, universities, and several of them are absolutely world class.
Correct.
Particularly Peking University, Tsinghua, Fudan.
Where you've been university. Teaching too.
Pardon?
You've taught there.
I've lectured there several, and I have many facts. I mean, for instance, one of my former postdocs, Wu Hong, is the Dean of Biology at Peking University.
Right.
And you know, she's hired literally dozens of top faculty there.
Right. You know, just to give you a picture, when I went to school here in the 80s, we had about 16,000 Indonesians all over the US at any given point.
Okay.
Right now it's less than 9,000.
Interesting, so it's dropped.
It's dropped. I would argue that some of the drop is attributable to some rotational behavior to other countries.
Yeah, yeah.
But, you know, that number should have been in the 100,000 at least. You know, you've got 450,000 Chinese in the U.S. You've got probably 150,000 to 200,000 Indians studying at...
And Indonesia's at that level of population.
It's not a small potato. It's 280 million people.
You're
probably likely to see more Singaporeans at any campus.
Which
in the
has,
US,
what, 5 Europe, million people?
5.5 million.
Yeah.
You're probably now likely to see more Vietnamese, you know.
Interesting, yeah.
At MIT, you know. Vietnam has a lot smaller population, less than 100 million people.
Oh, yeah.
And it's a game of scale, right, for the benefit of all of Southeast Asia.
Look, it's all education.
Yeah.
It's all higher education and the willingness of the governments and the politicians to put the money in there.
Right.
The United States, our education system works because it's largely private.
Right.
Most, certainly not all, but most of the top universities are private.
Right.
And they're run by philanthropy, by grants, and variety of other things. A few of the states, like California, have extensively supported the universities.
Yeah.
Berkeley or the University of Virginia or Wisconsin or many others are absolutely world class. But not all the states do it.
Yeah. Harvey, this has been great, but I want to ask you one last question. This is on a topic of artificial intelligence versus biological intelligence. Artificial intelligence seems to have grown quite exponentially, right?
Oh, it absolutely has.
Do you foresee the kind of exponentiality with which works on biotech will be moving?
Well, I mean, AI is heavily influencing biology. I mean, the most spectacular recent ones were AI programs that predict the three-dimensional structure of proteins from their amino acid sequences, which is a Google offspring. It was done at Google. And they can predict which is something academic scientists could never do, but actually predict with a great deal of success the molecular structure of proteins. And that can greatly expedite drug development, because if you have the structure of the protein, you can begin imagining how a small molecule might interact with it and change its properties, inhibit it, or turn it on, or whatever, as a drug.
So
the future is pretty bright.
And you see biotech not being able to grow as exponentially as...
Well, okay, I can't help you.
Okay.
Biotech is growing by leaps and bounds.
It has, certainly.
AI is growing by leaps and bounds. AI is influencing biotech in great ways.
Wow.
You know, another is in diagnostics. That is, in radiology, looking at an X-ray and trying to decide if the patient has lung cancer. AI programs can often do that better than the most highly trained radiologists. Okay?
Amazing.
So AI and biology are merging, and that will become very important in the future. It's already becoming important. Okay?
I'm glad to hear that.
Good.
Any final message for all of us in Southeast Asia?
Build up your universities, build up your education systems, and train people locally in these modern techniques, these new developments in biotech, in AI, and whatnot, to help the country solve whatever problems it has. Biological problems, medical problems, agricultural problems, and so forth. It all hinges on better education systems.
Thank you so much, Harvey.
Well, thank you for coming to my office and
interviewing
me.
It's swell.
Okay.
That was Harvey Lodish from the Whitehead Institute. Thank you.
Inilah Endgame.
Okay. Very good.
My gosh, that was...
Okay.
Thank you so much, my man.
Okay, listen. Dr. Silver. Doctor.
That's me.
That's you.
I'll text you later.
Yeah, no. I'll just show you. When we were in Vietnam, and this is my granddaughter, and there was another guy on the boat besides the crew whom he introduced as his cousin. It wasn't his cousin.
This is a picture of me, my family.